What do we mean by security? How is the term used in the mainstream media? What do leaders mean by it? When they state that they are protecting our security, should we believe them, or do we have reason to be more doubtful? Here to discuss these and other related questions with us is Francesco Strizzari, Professor of International Relations at the Sant'Anna School of Advanced Studies in Pisa, Italy. His work focuses on security policies, political violence, and extra-legal governance, and geographically, on Africa, the Mediterranean, and the Balkans. He is founder of the collective blog Security Praxis that provides a platform for discussion of current events and cultural artifacts related to security politics, policies, and routines.
Greetings and welcome to the first session of the Alternative Security Conference. So I would like to invite Professor Francesco Strizzari and to join us in the session. Thank you, Francesco, for joining us.
Hi, everyone.
Great. So let's start into the questions. So one of your research areas is the transnational organized crime, which policymakers in Europe see it as an increasingly important unconventional security threat. So maybe to start our discussion or dialogue, maybe we can start first by just defining what is transnational organized crime within the policymaker spheres, and what do they mean by unconventional security threat?
Yeah, let's start by what is unconventional, because we need to have a sense of what is conventional. When we talk about security, conventional threats, we are typically designing condition that has to do with national security, with the traditional idea that what is to be secured, the referent object of security, is the state against potential aggression. Its integrity, its borders are to be protected and kept free from threat or risk. When we talk about the unconventional field of threats, we are typically referring to a broader catalog of threats that materialize in the transnational field, in an area which is transversal and definitely not captured by the idea that the international space is divided by clearly delimited states, sovereign entities, where there's a clear inside and an outside, and the referent object is the sovereign, what is order. And in fact, what we see there is what the Derrian NIR specialist, international relations specialist, defined the metaphysics of Western security thinking. That is the idea that we have, on the one hand, authority, the center, order, and identity, and on the other hand, we have anarchy, we have chaos, and we have difference. This is the kind of traditional terms through which thinking about security have been articulated historically. Now, when we talk about unconventional threats, we talk about phenomena that are not easily captured by that representation, and that come to the attention of the international community mainly by the end of the Cold War and its fixation, let's say, with understanding security in terms of strategic thinking, in terms of nuclear deterrence, in terms of alliances, only where the protagonists, the who is to achieve security and provide security, is the state only. And the aggressor is typically another state. Now, with the fall of the Iron Curtain, the entire understanding of security is undergoes a major transformation with the broadening of the catalog and with the deepening of the levels of analysis from beyond the state as a unit towards the individual on the one hand, and the understanding of global security. It is in that context that transnational organized crime that is understood with a lot of ambivalence, because we do have, as a matter of fact, an international convention against transnational organized crime. That's a Palermo Convention of 2000. But the definition that is given by states there is extremely, extremely broad and, let's say, generic. So it doesn't allow discriminating very much about what kind of threat are we addressing. Well, it is from then that we understand that either the domestic dimension of crime goes international, and there's a lot of literature. It's a quite of alarmistic literature that becomes widespread in the 90s in terms of globalization being taken over or propelled by criminal interests. And at the same time, there is a kind of resobering, a way of analyzing the role that criminal interest and organized crime have in the international space, by not only being domestic actors, let's say the Italian Cosa Nostra going international or transnational, but as a matter of fact, internationally born new configurations that are possible because they become they're intimately connected with the legal dimension of international trade and international economy. Sure. And so it's not only it's shadow, but it's actually interconnected and interwoven with the global markets.
So in principle, there was a shift after, for example, if you take in Europe, there was a shift going from the national state, the nation state as an enclosed economic sphere, to the EU as a broader open market space. There was a shift in this idea of what is crime and what is it not transnational crime. Is it right? If I understood your point correctly, as within that period, within the historical narrative.
Yes, it's there's a refocusing on a number of new threats. Transnational organized crime is one. The entire emphasis on trafficking, on porous borders, which go, you know, hand in hand with a different understanding of global markets. And the way in which as states are seeing retreating in their regulatory power and capacity, illicit interests and illicit actors might be propelling globalization through their shadow agendas in the form of extra legal governance, if you like. Now, this is one part of the picture, because you know, the idea that states have been just withdrawing and retreating and just leaving way to market interest only captures one aspect of the way in which the states have been developing the past few decades. It is a fact that we observe a number of forms of criminalization in a number of areas of goods and services and activities that were not considered illicit beforehand. There's a long history of criminalization, from counterfeited goods to a work of art. And what we see is that, as a matter of fact, the state has been expanding its law enforcement capacity precisely by using the idea that it is fighting organized crime, transnational organized crime, and that new unconventional and non-traditional threats correspond to the emergence of risks for the well-being of our societies, which require stronger powers to fight them. That has been part of the reallocation of budget to law enforcement and intelligence communities when one could have understood their role being de-emphasized with the end of the equilibrium of terror during the Cold War.
But can you give somehow examples, like if we say when we're talking how they are, the budgets are shifting more towards security and intelligence service. So if you look at refugees or migration, if you take this as an example, that's being said that it's a security threat. And we saw, like, for instance, in Europe, Frontex, how the budgets is increasing in this, to go more in the security direction, but without addressing the roots of the problem. Somehow it's just saying that this is an easy solution, let's go through it. So can you elaborate more on how these policies are being generated and developed, and what are the forces behind them somehow?
Sure. Well, it's a process that the Copenhagen School, to name some academic constellations from the beginning of the 90s, has defined securitization. That's how a given issue, which might be politicized or dealt through technical skills, or might actually be escalated through a speech act and being defined as a security threat or even as a military threat when we start talking about migrants invading our countries and the need for protecting our borders. This shift in the mode of representation is something that calls into the game different actors. You know, migrants can be seen as an economic frontier, as an economic challenge in terms of social integration, in terms of economic opportunity, or they can be seen as a matter of public order, an identity threat, an existential threat, and so on and so forth. This process of refocusing of a number of issue areas towards the security end of the political spectrum is what is typically defined securitization, and it typically calls for the adoption of emergential and extraordinary means, preferential lane for giving priority to ways of addressing the problem that are not the way in which in a parliamentary liberal democracy things should go. That might be exceptions made in the face of the danger that a given phenomena might present. And this is one area where we observe the expansion of the security speak and the adoption of security mode of intervention. It's just one, because as a matter of fact, we should probably go back to the matrix of militarized responses for facing with social and political problems, which is the war on drugs. The war on drugs is what is declared by President Nixon in 1971, when the definition is offered to the public of war of drugs being public enemy number one, and anything should be done, whatever it takes, including the use of the military abroad, to tackle what is a problem, a social problem domestically in the United States. That's the beginning of a way of addressing an issue which brings about further reframing in terms of security and even military problems.
Yeah, you point out to the war on drugs. Bruce Alexander, who's wrote the book "The Globalization of Addiction," talks about how the war on drugs has kind of made the thing even worse, because it didn't deal with the roots of the problem, which is dislocation, war, and isolation, and all these that has to be is coupled with the modern modernity somehow. But do you think that this for instance, the war on drugs, is it just mere speculation, lack of knowledge, or is it there were different forces, for example, the industries, the military industries, who had vested interests in order to get contracts, especially in the US where the contracts are privatized? Or do you see similar approaches in Europe, or is it different?
Well, there are different things there. I mean, The war on drugs goes with a strong criminalization of any activities related to drugs on the supply and on the demand side, but mainly targeting the supply side through military means. The idea of addressing any problem through the security spectrum, through the labeling that as a security threat, has to do with also the expansion of the idea that the condition of security has to do not only with the existence of tangible, palpable threats, but also with risks, which is a completely different story, because a risk is something that is always present, and we are mammals, we are born insecure and vulnerable, and it's something that cannot be eliminated. But the more the emphasis goes on the idea of risk, and therefore the idea of insuring against the risk, the more the idea of dealing with everything in terms of security is expanded. So what we observe there is that migrants, drug addiction, dissent, armed groups, everything undergoes the idea of deep criminalization and dealing with that in terms of, strong measures, zero tolerance, and that kind of jargon, which became pretty much mainstream. Now, the problem is that all of that goes without a sober empirical assessment of the results. And it is, anybody can understand today, just to make an example, that, 20 years on since the war on terror was proclaimed by President George W. Bush, the outcome is elusive, to say the least, if not a disaster in any possible scenarios, to the point that, states are negotiating with the terrorists, with the Taliban in Afghanistan, with Al-Qaeda in the Sahel. And this is, something anybody can observe, but the recipe as such is not publicly acknowledged to be flawed. And the same goes with drugs. We have decades of illustrations of the way in which criminalization might have played into the hands of economic interests, of organized criminal groups, distorting public debate, the public sphere, from assessing demand and supply in a balanced way. And every possible target has been totally missed. The idea of containing the use of heavy drugs to only 5% of the global population, totally missed. And yet states have a problem making steps back from the declaration of war and to the use of the frame of war making to deal with problems, because they are afraid of losing legitimacy. So much legitimacy has been put into labeling the enemy as terrorist, as addicted, and so on, that is difficult to publicly admit. And therefore we observe a fragmented consensus in every area of policy today. That is also offering an opportunity, by the way.
Yeah, so I have a couple of interesting things that, one with that idea of always bringing the war rhetoric. We saw it in the pandemic when the French president said, okay, this is a war, like we have to be prepared. It's also using this war rhetoric in a corrupted way somehow. But when you mentioned like how the US is kind of was dealing with Taliban, but also they supported them when they had to, so when they were fighting against the USSR. So the idea of terror can, or what is terrorist, or what is terror, or who is our enemy and who is our friend, is kind of also kind of gets corrupted, because in day and night everything shifts based on the ruling interests of certain states. So in general, the society kind of gets confused, or who are we supporting, and what are the reasons? But it's also for a small group of it.
Mohammed, you're totally right. I mean, when we talk about criminalization and organized crime on the one hand and terrorism on the other, we are skating on very thin ice in terms of legal consensus and understanding. Let's start from the criminal side. It happens so often that criminal elements are co-opted in the context of international military interventions, because you don't want them to converge with the terrorist jihadists and so on into one single intractable enemy front. And therefore, who is the criminal and who is just a clientelistic bad guy that we can deal with in terms of stabilizing under a stabilization agenda is something that is very much cast in doubt. Corrupted elites, useful dictators that are basing themselves on generalized stealing, all of that can be condoned if there are higher stakes politically, or they are perceived to be higher. When it comes to terrorism, it goes even beyond the traditional motto, whereby someone's freedom fighter is someone else's terrorist. Today we don't observe any single war front in among the many armed conflicts in the world where the enemy is not labeled a terrorist. That has to do with a legitimacy question. We live in the information age, and although we think we are in a post-ideological era, we're very much inside an ideological era. I mean, Slavoj Žižek is very much on that point. Ideology is what is transparent, what we don't see, what is considered to be common sense. And therefore, the production of image of the enemy image and the delegitimization of the enemy image. And it has to do with the idea that we don't recognize the legitimacy of dissent and of the existence of enemies that are not terrorists, that we can negotiate with, that we can have, to whom we can apply, for example, the Geneva Conventions in terms of fundamental freedoms of war prisoners. We need to invent Guantanamo. We need to invent spaces of exception everywhere. And that, of course, instead of transforming towards a more civilized end, thought in terms of emancipatory feelings and so on, the destruction of international relations, it brings it down to more uncivilized and less universal positions, where the exception become the norm, and where whenever we adopt the jargon of war, we're actually talking about hierarchies, and we're in fact talking about the suspension of democracy. So saying that something, we are at war, you know, it means, hey baby, we are on a special mission here, shut up. And that closes spaces of democracy, or at least pluralism, if not democracy, and suspends with implications, at least for a certain period, but how long is that period, and with what limits, suspends fundamental guarantees that exist in democratic orders.
And where do you see the role of the media of kind of given this rhetoric, the megaphone, and then no one kind of, it becomes difficult to have this pluralism and democracy in a certain way, that we see the media is kind of weighed open to the state's rhetoric most of the time?
Well, absolutely. I mean, actually, the media are you know, part of the problem, the solution, in the sense that they offer a way of checking, a way of triangulating news. We know way much more about you know, criminal behaviors, and therefore the public opinion lives on the existence of media and social media. At the same time, much of those mechanisms, many of those mechanisms, are about sensationalism, and that about what some has been defining meta-terrorism, the idea that facing with a terror attack in the past few years, what we see on the media, instead of having, I don't know, as a pundit or as an expert, sociologist of visual culture that explains how terrorists communicate and puts things under an interpretive frame and allows to understand what is the message and how the message is built, and therefore to deconstruct that and to allow the wider public to understand what is the stake in that message, why ISIS uses Hollywood post-production techniques. What we get is some generals who just talk about, from that episode, how we might be exposed to a next biological nuclear attack. And therefore, everything is about the speculation of future apocalyptic scenarios. That creates a kind of broad anxiety, which lays the ground for militarized answers to come. And the problem with that is that this is linked, and this is a very important problem. You know, if what I said is that by the end of the Cold War, there was an attempt to bring security to a reconceptualization in terms of human security, the security of individuals, not so much security in terms of control of territory, but in terms of people and in terms of what societies are about. The fact that securing the state doesn't mean making the people more secure. Sometimes actually it's the opposite. Well, what we observe today, we are entering a post-human society where, security practices are to be developed in a condition of risk, and we use algorithmic mechanisms. That is, we need to act in a condition of uncertainty, not when we have evidence, but we don't have evidence. And that means we create machine learning mechanisms, machines that are able to digest everybody's data, to create a statistic sense of what is normal, and then to understand what is the deviance. And therefore, those who think, well, I have nothing to hide, you know, I can put all of my data out in the public. In fact, they're feeding the machine. They're feeding the monster, which allows to single out in a post-human mechanism who the enemy is and those mechanisms of militarization. And make no mistake there, the machine means that nobody has political responsibility. So it's a way of depoliticizing the mechanism, and we're playing with fire, we're playing with fundamental freedoms. A fake positive might have huge implications for an entire society.
Yeah, and on this point of how also when people try to expose these things, like for example, to mention a few, like Julian Assange or Edward Snowden or Chelsea Manning, and there are a lot of others, they kind of also being labeled as traitors of the state. So in the end, as you said, like the truth becomes obscure. No one is in charge. No one is responsible. So you don't know who to refer to or to put in, or to persecute or to say, okay, that's what's a mistake. We need to correct it. So and this with automated decision making makes it more problematic because it's not everybody who even the ones who are developing these procedures, they don't understand how they work. So in a sense, it's very messy kind of.
Well, I mean, post-human, Mohammed, means that when you are at the border, crossing a border, and someone checks your document, it's just a flag coming from a computer due to the fact that someone might have called you, and it's completely imprescrutable. You don't know what is the chain of responsibility behind you being, blacklisted or whitelisted. And you may be a donation to a child in Gaza, and then you end up with some black mechanism because some software that checks everybody's reliability in terms of banking, produces some knowledge about you that you don't have access to, and you can't resort to any judicial power to undo that. But what you said rightly by pointing to the case of Assange and so on, I mean, let's think about one single fact. Let me take it a bit long, but I think it's very important. One critical aspect about security is not only what security is and whose security is to provide security, but also how is security to be achieved. Now, there are different answers in history and in terms of social sciences. Traditionally, it's about diplomacy and the military, in terms of state, national security, and so on. Then it becomes way more articulated with liberal thinking in terms of, it's trade. It's trade and democracy. That's the liberal piece. Now, another corner of that is that, which is, corrective vis-a-vis the others, or might be a different paradigm, is it's about participatory mechanisms. It's about a solidaristic understanding of society, society-to-society dialogue. That is very important for the demise of the Cold War, peace building as a subversive practice in the 80s, pacifist movements, and security out of the involvement and the active mobilization of citizens, a trans-border mobilization. Now, what we see with the Assange and other cases like that is, in fact, that, it is technically possible to come to denounce episodes, grave violations, systematic violation of human rights, which are definitely not in the interest of the West, among others, in the sense of maintaining a certain consistency and a strong ideological appeal, a way of convincing that it's better to go to intervene for a good cause than not. So even in from that point of view, the fact that there are mechanisms denouncing abuse should be important. And yet what we observe is that Assange is in prison and none of the war crimes that his organization has denounced have been persecuted. And that's the paradox, there's a big fail there. One might discuss, and there might be points to say that Assange has exposed this and that, and it's always a problem of whether, ethically speaking, it's about an ethics of conviction. I'm using Max Weber here. I'm doing something because it's right, or an ethics of consequences. I'm doing something because it will have certain consequences, and it's about responsibility. There might be arguments for either and for both, but the fact that nobody is paying for crimes that have been denounced that are so clear, private corporations, military corporations shooting on harmless civilians just for the sake of it, that is a cry of indignation that is there open in the open.
So yeah, for instance, like the invasion of Iraq, like till now George Bush and Tony Blair are still kind of free to do whatever they want without being kind of at least persecuted because of the war crimes that they were committed.
That's crucial. Reasons. That's crucial. I mean, we have been discussing for years about terrorism and how terrorism became so pervasive and attacking Europe and then the Bataclan and so on. But if you pay attention, it's very difficult in a public debate to say, you know, it all started with the invasion of Iraq. That set into motion a chain of activities that destabilized Syria by sending foreign fighters back and forth the borders, and Al-Qaeda became the Islamic State in the middle of that, invasion. Going back to claiming responsibility, political and moral and even judicial responsibility for the invasion of Iraq as a turning point based on lies, it's something that is difficult to say on a public TV confrontation. People say, oh, come on, we're going back to that, you know, primal scene. But this primal scene is crucial. It has been setting the entire Middle East into flame, and the domino effect that should have been democracy is what we see today. You know, instead of having a ring of friends and democratic leaders, we have a ring of autocrats and dictators and human rights trumpeted and destroyed everywhere.
Yeah, so in principle, it's the idea of justice, of having justice, not just saying, okay, now, so I almost have the feeling that our understanding of time and historical events and how they're interconnected is being also kind of corrupted, and we don't kind of take it seriously. But I would like now to move a bit more into also, I know that you are working also on the Sahel and the region, how the security interventions by, for instance, France is also destabilizing the region. So can you elaborate more on what's the situation there in the Sahel and how these military interventions keep on feeding this insecurity?
Well, the Sahel is a hard topic, and it's very topical, in fact, because much of the mobilization for projection of security apparatuses in Europe now is about the Sahel. And the kind of widespread rhetoric is that the Sahel is a threat for European security. Le Drian, France Minister of Foreign Affairs, repeated that in the last couple of days. Well, let's start from some evidence. There is no single attack coming from the Sahel to European inside European borders so far. That might be changing, of course, in the future. But for much emphasis on how the Sahel is the underbelly of a destabilization chain, there's no evidence so far. What there is evidence about is that after 9/11, attention came to this region because of a number of tourists being kidnapped, and you know, the very name of Sahel as the kind of semi-arid strip of land just south of the Sahara Desert, you know, wasn't part of the self-perception of people up to very recent times. We are talking about an area extremely poor, some of the poorest countries in the world, that in the past few years made major investments in the security apparatus, four times as many, as much as before, as opposed to development goals. And that has been done with the assistance of the West and assistance of Europe and other countries. And we're talking about an area that is now part of global competition between key international players. The US is somehow back into the picture after Trump. Russia is very much assertive in the other area, from Central African Republic to events in Chad, Russia being accused of through mercenaries to have provided weapons to rebels and behind the killing of the president of Chad, a dictator that was very close to France. China being very present and European Union countries deploying special forces through the Takuba task force. United Nations there with a number of international stabilization missions. Everybody's there right now in a big mess, by the way, because there's a big problem of coordination among local actors with international actors. And we're talking about a very poor region that came in on the spotlight after 9/11. Let's say with the US for the first time calling for a Trans-Saharan counter-terror initiative. At that point, it was not clear there were terrorists there. So what one can say, and it's not so much of a provocation, there's groundings for saying that, is does counter-terror come before or after the appearance of terror? Because at that point, sure, there was a potential for civil war in Algeria and the its own spillover onto the southern region. But for example, the transformation of the Algerian Salafist Islamic group into Al Qaeda is after that. It's from 2006, 2007, after 9/11. So the first question is, when we talk about terror and counterterrorism, is sometimes to think what comes first? Who calls the shots for the other? There's clearly an interaction there between deployments and what happens locally in extremely fragile context, poor context, where the idea of the state or modern state is very recent. We're talking about in northern Mali, in Kidal, the first modern school was opened there 100 years ago. Before that, there were different forms of society and polities, very much linked to semi-nomadic forms of circulation, which didn't consider borders the way we understand them, as a line in the sand, but as a matter of societal relations. And, you know, imposing the idea that security is about more borders and less circulation, curfews, electrified fences, drones controlling people, it has a huge impact, is having a huge impact on the way people live, because, you know, you don't live in the desert if you don't move. The desert is a space of circulation. So if you start saying no migrants across there because they all come to Europe, it's not true. It's about 20-30% who try to reach Europe. Many others are part of circular migrations and therefore of the local economy. And, you know, putting fences everywhere, as President Trump used to say, why don't you build a big sand wall like we did with Mexico, as if that would solve the security problems in Europe. Well, that's precisely the problem. We're talking about an extremely fragile area where not only Al-Qaeda, but also the Islamic State have become extremely active. They even fight against one another to see who's leading the insurgency and what kind of Islam will prevail, what kind of jihadist version of Islam will prevail. There are other much broader configurations of political Islam, both on the Turkish Muslim Brothers, Qatar side, and on the other countries of the Gulf, Saudi Arabia, Emiratis side, fighting one another politically. Entire societies are being transformed by these new forms of attention. And it's an extremely poor area undergoing major transformations under the challenge of climate crisis, because that's where you feel climate change happening already in terms of desertification, in terms of inundation, in terms of variability. So a big problem that is tackled only through security lenses. Now, we should welcome the fact that the European Union, after some difficult start, has just published a new strategy which brings to the center the problem of governance. Who's governing those countries? I mean, are local governments part of the problem or the solution? What is the relation between corruption, clientelism, patronage, and the fact that people can't bear it, can't take it anymore, and you know they go for the bush, and the young population goes for the jihadist in many areas.
Mm-hmm. Sorry to interrupt, but just when you mentioned the EU is having this strategy, so I'm wondering like how or what legitimized this intervention from the EU or from other outside states. So when they intervene there and when they say we have a plan, is it just trying to confront the colonial legacy to make things better? So where is the local agency of the people saying, okay, we don't want this? Because I don't want to switch to another region, because maybe you can, if you want to elaborate, and then we can quickly switch because we're almost running out of time, unfortunately. But yeah.
Okay, so the colonial question is important. The post-colonial dimension in understanding security is extremely important here. When we talk about colonial power, we talk about mainly about France, but also Italy as much as Libya is concerned, and the Great Britain in terms of the other Anglophone areas of West Africa. But It's important because it's a kind of semi-hidden dimension here, which is exploited very much, for example, by Turkey, that is having a very assertive line in Africa right now. Turkey saying, you know, we are an anti-colonial, part of the anti-colonial decolonization struggle. Turkey, that was there as part of the Ottoman Empire, by the way. So, I mean, it's not colonial, but it's imperial or imperialist, if you like. And the same goes with China. And the same goes with a number of other forces that are moving behind the scenes. Now, what your point is important because it's actually the local states, the local leaders who called in external partners. But who are they? Okay, so in the case of Mali, which started the entire problem, we're talking about an implosion of the state, you know, a rebellion in the north, the state melting, a coup d'etat, a first coup d'etat. We had the second one last year, and the second coup d'etat was actually organized by military that the European Union was training, has been training. So there's a bit of a problem there, as a matter of fact, you know, what kind of training and how loyal are they to the principle of democratic governance and so on. So yes, there is an invitation, which is part of a legal framework, formally speaking, but we're talking about extremely weak governments that are flagging their need or their interest in being beneficiaries of counter-terror aid, since the development aid is shrinking. So say, oh, we have a big terrorist problem. And it is not that there is no insurgency there. We have a major insurgency by now. It says Boko Haram, and you have the Islamic State in the Greater Sahara, and you have Al-Qaeda creating an umbrella organization, and we have other formations fighting. If you look at the data, it's a clear escalation throughout the entire region, involving Burkina, Niger, Mali, and further afield. But what is important is how this partnership is structured, which is there a transformative agenda there? And that's what has been missing so far. There's been an agenda looking at, for example, how the European Union has been diverting the EU Trust Fund for Africa from being a broad program onto mainly being captured by the fear of migrations not being contained. And what happened in the past few years, and hopefully is changing now, the European Union has opened, for example, its new strategy to contribution from anyone. And that's a good, a welcome development, the first time it happened. What is important is that those civil society organizations that in the past, up to 10 years ago, were considered the best allies of the European Union as a transformative power, as a power being born beyond geopolitics, as a way of proposing a different idea of peace, of regional of peace that was not just the classical idea of absence of war and realpolitik and the raison d'etat. Well, what happened in the past 10 years due to this fear of migrations especially, has been that those NGOs and civil society became the worst enemies. They became hostile to European Union. And at the same time, the local leaders were paying lip service by saying, our main problem is terrorism, our main problem is migration. It's not. The main problem is that no running water. The main problem is no schooling. All schools are closed due to insurgency in those areas. There's an entire generation born and growing illiterate, only under jihadist teaching, and that's a huge problem for the future.
This approach kind of reminds me also what's happening in Lebanon. So how the ruling elites or structures are kind of alluding with the kind of asking for benefits from the outside, but also eliminating any possible, or trying to eliminate any possible transformation within the society. So when I hear, I mean, one example is what happened last year after the 4th of August explosion in Beirut. So the French president went there and then he kind of brought everybody together and said, okay, you have to put your act together and try to fix it. But in a sense, he kind of continuing this idea of stability that the European Union wants to have in the region. So, but there are parties and recent parties, for example, citizens within a state who are having ideas and plans to transform the society, but are kind of being sidelined by the major or the international community so that they maintain this idea of stability. So can you quickly maybe unfortunately, we are running out of time to elaborate on this. What do they mean by the idea of stability? Is it just for their own benefits, just to have markets and the flow of capital?
Let me answer philosophically here. Okay, yes. So, you know, our understanding of security is very much tilted toward this idea of stability, as if there was chaos there out there, pre-existing our act of knowing it and speaking it. So the idea, which is very much from Hobbes, is that the only way out of that instability, this kind of state of nature and chaos, is by alienating our freedom, that is our agency, onto a third overimposed element, that is the sovereign, the Leviathan in Hobbes terms. By adopting that philosophy, we rule out that security can be born out of solidarity and cooperation among individuals and organizations and people and actors. So if we choose that line, the idea that the only form of security is stability, well, then we have, like it's the idea that the peace can be the peace of the graveyard, peace can be the Pax Mafiosa. Whereas if we adopt a different critical understanding of security as a transformative process that can be normatively inclined towards liberation politics, towards liberating human potential, then we get a different answer. I'm not saying that there's no need for acknowledging the fact that there are power configurations, there are ruling classes, and they are, you know, kleptocratic, and we need to engage them. But are we engaging them for a purpose, or are we engaging them for the sake of putting things down? That's a dilemma for the European Union. Is there a way of injecting a transformative element in our understanding of security? Now, let me conclude on that. If you go back to the writings about security in the 16th and 15th and 17th century, you basically get two understandings. One is security as a preservation of integrity from external aggression, the classical idea of safety, physical safety, and so on. And the other understanding is security used in a more negative connotation, the idea of security as someone's misplaced overconfidence, careless overconfidence, complacency about, feeling, I am beyond doubt, I'm here to stay. Shakespeare or Edmund Burke, Shakespeare even wrote in Macbeth, security is mortal's chief enemy. When you feel too secure, you don't understand the challenges of change. Well, that's a mortal definition of security. And it has disappeared in history as our understanding of security, but I believe it's very important to understand that it is a contested meaning, and we need to keep it open for definition, because an overconfident understanding of security means that the European Union and ourselves lie on the wrong side of history.
That sounds really great. Thank you. Thank you, Professor Shatsari, for joining us. And we hope that our audience also found this interesting and enjoyed it. And we see you on the next session.
Thank you very much, and have a good conference. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.